Level C1, Lesson 7, Multimedia, Dershowitz Convicts DSK. Listening. Now listen to the second part of the article. Many rape victims have credibility issues. But what does it say to future rape victims if a case with this much physical evidence and credible outcry witnesses gets dropped because the victim lied about how she got in the country and other personal issues? Please take another look, Davis pleaded. Dershowitz obliged, and he reversed his thinking. The decision on whether Strauss-Kahn was guilty or innocent shouldn't rest with prosecutors, but with the jury. Soon after, Dershowitz called me up at Newsweek to describe his change of heart. He was willing to go on the record saying so. And he wanted to do one better. For weeks, he had been looking for a fresh subject for his fall legal ethics class at Harvard. Now he had a theme. How would you, America's future lawyers, handle the DSK prosecution? Before Dershowitz started with his mock court lesson, though, he needed to set a few predicates for his students, now acting as the jurors. First, Dershowitz would tell the jury they had every right to doubt the accuser. Second, Dershowitz would seek to get entered into evidence a picture of Strauss-Kahn's naked body, possibly from the police forensic exam after his arrest. If that failed, Dershowitz would have to help his jurors picture in their imagination a naked 62-year-old DSK, overweight and slightly hunched, his chest sunken and his skin sagging from the natural progression of age. With the ground rules established, Dershowitz took center stage. "Ladies and gentlemen of the jury," he started, "we have enough evidence to convict this man beyond a reasonable doubt, even if you don't believe the accuser. In fact, we are prepared to concede that based on statements she's made in other contexts, you would be within your right to have some suspicions about her credibility." The classroom was silent, with students hanging on every word. "What we are asking you to do is to look at all the facts in the case and decide based on all the facts whether she is in fact telling the truth about this one instance, mainly that she was sexually assaulted in that hotel room," Dershowitz bellowed in his usual impassioned courtroom voice. "Ladies and gentlemen, you have seen the photograph of Dominique Strauss-Kahn naked. Now I want you to imagine for a second him walking out of the shower, stark naked, and this young woman who you see before you, an attractive young woman, looks at him." Finally, there are a few giggles from the juror's box, then another hush. "Now the theory of the defense is that she looked at him and could not resist her lustful temptations to have 7 minutes of oral sex with this man. She simply couldn't control herself," he continued, a touch of sarcasm in his voice. "She didn't do it for pay, because if she did, you would have heard in the media or this courtroom the theory that this was a financial transaction. She didn't do it because she was forced to, if you believe the defense. She did it because she wanted to. And why would she want to? The only reason she would want to, according to the defense, is that she was so lustfully driven by this beautiful 62-year-old, white-haired, overweight man's presence that she couldn't resist his chops." Dershowitz elicited healthy laughter with that last line, a sign that the student jurors were beginning to see the absurdity of DSK's defense. Now, the legal scholar wanted to remind them of the forensic evidence pointing to a sexual encounter that was forced, unplanned, and uncomfortable from the victim's point of view. "She must have been really enticed by this man's beauty because she was willing to have this sexual encounter in just 7 minutes, with her maid's uniform still on. Remember, that's where we found his DNA, on her uniform top. And it doesn't appear she arrived planning on such an encounter either. There's no nightie or sexy lingerie. In fact, she wore two pantyhose that day, hardly the attire of a woman looking for casual sex in a hotel room. And so we don't forget, let me remind you also where this all happened. He rented a $3,000 a night suite, one worthy of a honeymoon. It's got a big bed and a glorious living room, but that's not where this all went down. In fact, this sexual encounter seems to occur in the most inglorious of all places. She was prostrate on the floor, her back pressed to a wall in a narrow hallway near a bathroom, right where we found that DNA. And when this encounter ends, how does the woman the defense says who couldn't control her sexual desires show her appreciation? by spitting his semen on the floor and running out of the room. The giggles and laughter are now yielding to a slow boiling anger. Now, ladies and gentlemen of the jury, if you believe that story, you should acquit. And if you don't believe that, if you say to yourself that there is no plausible basis for that account, then you have to seriously consider the prosecution's account, mainly that she was forced to submit to his sexual advances. When you then look at that and put that in the context of the timeline that morning, the semen stains on her dress, his DNA on her crotch, the sickened, disgusted way she acted in the immediate aftermath when she encountered the outcry witnesses, I'm confident you will conclude beyond a reasonable doubt that he sexually assaulted her. And you can do so whether or not you believe she is a woman who is generally credible in other aspects of life, whether or not this is a woman who has previously lied about other important matters in her life. Yes, she lied to get into the country, but so have many other immigrants seeking a better life. And yes, she told the prosecutors a bogus story about an earlier rape in her homeland because that is what her immigration advisor instructed her to memorize. We'll concede that, Dershowitz said.